guys.
All right, but this is the Cold War. But now look at this definition. This definition looks a little imposing. Like that's, boy, that's the definition of the Cold War.
You don't have to bake anything.
But this definition is, you know, you look at this and you go, hey, yeah, that's a lot. But you know, this is kind of the, this is the entire slideshow in one slide. And our lecture is now over. Yes. I have another 82 slides to go. Yes.
Oh, I have a question. Like, in the chapter, like, when we talk about the Cold War, when we were talking about, like, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization and the United Nations, was that all during the Cold War?
Yes.
Or was it, like, after?
All during.
Or?
I'm going to get to all those.
And okay.
And what else?
Yeah. I just like don't get how like it can all be tied in.
It's all tied in because this event that never happened. And the word there is called protracted. That's a tough word.
How could it
The Cold War was the protracted geopolitical, ideological, and economic struggle. So three types of a struggle. It's political, politics. So it's ideological, what your belief system is. So it's geopolitical, US versus USSR. It's ideological, it's democracy versus communism, and it's also economic. It's capitalism versus socialism. So it's on three different levels, this war. Now this is, it's not a war, it's really a struggle. I like the way that's put there. And it's protracted. Protracted means it's kind of pulled back a little bit. It's not all the way. It's a reserve struggle. It emerges after World War II between those two big powers, Soviet Union and United States, supported by their respective alliances. We're going to talk about that, these alliances. Now, here's the thing. Go back to what were the causes of World War I? What was the A stand for?
Alliances.
Alliances. You're going to see three of the causes of World War I kind of apply perfectly to the Cold War. We were just lucky enough for that, for the Cold War not to emerge.
Yeah.
You know, when World War I did. Yeah, a second a bullet point there, it was called Cold because it didn't involve direct conflict between these two. But it involved other things, and here's a bunch of them, okay? Diplomatic maneuvering, economic pressure, selective aid, intimidation, propaganda, assassination, low-intensity military operations, and full proxy wars. So it was all these different things that went engaged, never necessarily from one side to the next. Propaganda from one side to the next. United States makes a movie called Rocky IV. Have you seen it? Rocky goes to Russia and beats this horrible Russian boxer who was all steroided up and trained, and guess what the whole crowd does at the end of Rocky IV? He's in Moscow, and they start chanting, USA, USA, and you walk out, you're like, whoa, I want to be a boxer, and I'm super proud to be an American. And guess what? I don't think people in Moscow were watching the film, and if they did, they wouldn't be chanting USA. But this is one of these things that made you, that's part of that propaganda. Okay, it's entertainment, but you sure sort of felt alive. Yes. What's that?
Rockies are there?
Six.
Oh my gosh, that's
really tired. But both sides did all of these. Okay, both sides worked. Did assassination. Both sides, not necessarily assassination, but intimidation and all this stuff. Okay. Along with that, the tail end of that bullet point is that we see the largest arms race in history. Regular arms race, meaning build up tanks and cannons, but also nuclear ones. We're going to talk about that later. And the Cold War lasted 4 decades. There's a date from 1947 to the end, to the late 80s, 1990s, when you guys are all right about being born. Just right afterwards, right? You're born. You guys are what,
92?
Okay. So, this year, capitalism and communism, this of the geopolitical, ideological, and economic, this is about the economic side of it. That is really about, you know, we call ourselves Democrats, right, or world democracy, but in many ways our economic system defines us more than anything else. Okay, stepping back, there is an alternative, and I'm going to hopefully get to this point at the end of the lecture, talking about the other world. You have what was created, if you remember, Churchill and FDR, they met during World War II. Remember, it was in that, they met on the boat. Remember, it was called the Atlantic Charter, and they pledged to let's never have a World War III happen again. And one of the things we should do is have a place where we can talk about fighting. As you get married, and next thing you know, you and your spouse aren't getting along so well, you're like, you know what? You're not listening to me, and you think that I don't listen to you. We need to go to a place and have somebody listen to our problems. What's that called? Go to a counselor or a therapist, right? You know what? Let's go to a safe venue where we can talk face to face and not yell at each other and get all angry. That's what the UN is. The UN is a gigantic therapy session. Sometimes therapy can get a little loud and angry, and sometimes that happens in the UN. Okay, because it's not one-to-one, it's everybody. It's a face-to-face venue where the players of the Cold War could discuss their issues. Interesting, though, is that some countries start to get in the UN and they don't care about the Cold War. What countries do you think really wouldn't care about U.S. versus Soviet Union?
Africa.
Yeah, primarily you think of Africa. They're newly decolonized countries, and they don't really give a lick about, hey, capitalism, communism, whatever. You guys can shop those things, but we care about the stuff that we care. What are some of these things new countries would want, you think? Healthcare is the big one. Nation building, infrastructure, industrialization, education. So that's what they say. They come in and say, hey, everybody, we're going to vote on this Cold War stuff. And they're like, no, we want to vote on education. We want there to be an organization committed that you guys can help education. We want the World Health Organization to help, right, clean water and medicine, all that sort of stuff. So the UN had two different approaches. There's the UN. The building, you know where the UN exists? It's in New York City. Yeah, that's where the headquarters are at. And you can see the second bullet point, the decolonization of Africa greatly makes the UN much, much larger. The UN has two sort of major components. Everybody gets a vote in what's called the General Assembly. So, hey, you're Sudan, you get a vote. You're United States, you get a vote. But the winners of World War II all got a special badge for the UN. They're the most trusted countries. Anybody know what that's called?
Lifetime member?
It's called the Security Council. The UN Security Council. United States, China, Britain, France, and the Soviet Union are all given, hey, the five of you will make the real decisions based on international security. Nowadays, I think we have, can you look it up and see how many other members are in the Security Council? I think there's seven. I think there's two rotating ones. Yes?
I thought it was five.
Used to be five. I think that, you'll look it up for us.
Yeah.
I think there's always now a rotating or two rotating members, so it could be different countries that have that are part of the Security Council. Yes.
How is China a part of the Security Council or whatever it is? If everyone was like against them because they're communism.
So was the Soviet Union. They're part of it too. They were all basically the winners of World War II. They were all the allies.
So winners of World War II.
Yeah, the winners of World War II is what it turned out to be. The countries that were most stable after World War II.
So it's U.S., USSR, China, Great Britain.
And France. Okay. So this goes along with, like I said, what kind of a conflict it is. Okay. This is a political contest between the two leaders?
No.
Who has got the most stuff? So what kind of a contest would that be? An economic one, right? Yeah. How well your country's doing economically, and what kind of goods are they throwing at each other? Not industrial goods, no.
Appliances?
Yes, and we know what you call that. iPods can be thrown in there, VCRs, which they don't make anymore, but you know what I mean? DVD player. What do you call that stuff for the average Joe, you, the person who buys stuff? What, you know what you're called when you go out and buy stuff? Starts with a C, ends in consumer.
Consumer.
What kind of goods are these called?
Consumer
goods. So this is a battle of consumer goods. Now, who do you think is going to win that battle, the U.S. or the USSR?
The U.S.
Yeah, the U.S. U.S. is going to win that. And in many ways, this became the gauge that determined who was successful. The United States pledged themselves on, you know what, hey, we're gonna have consumer goods to make lives, you know, for our people. The Soviet side says, you know what, those consumer goods are not for everybody. We promise to give everybody in our society enough for everybody. Does everybody in the country have an iPod? No. Everybody have a Blu-ray player? No. So those who are wealthy enough to afford it, yes, they get the good life. And the USSR says, no, we're going to provide enough for everybody. So the problem, though, is if you live in the USSR, guess what you want? I wouldn't mind some of those high-end consumer goods that those people in America have. Okay, but ultimately, they're high-end, so that means everybody can have them.
So
the United States has been seen as this, oh, we want their stuff. And in the 1980s, when I was a kid going to school, you would hear stories like, oh, if you could ever go to Russia, you go to Moscow, I'd bring like a suitcase of like Levi's. Right, because people just buy them up on the streets because they don't have those goods that started to become synonymous with being cool and being affluent. And so Nike shoes and Levi pants and, you know, Sony Walkmans, that kind of stuff, really popular, and started to win this consumer battle. Okay. Question, Jackie. Of course.
Russia had like more of a quantity in the United States.
Yes, the base necessities.
Okay.
All right, so now let's step back and look a bit and see where this Cold War is going to actually happen. Because it doesn't happen in downtown Washington, in Washington, D.C., or downtown Moscow. It happens in all these other places because the Cold War is going to spread out. Now, one place it spreads out, the place where we see a lot of this, is what was left over with Europe. Europe was in ruins after World War II and World War I. Anybody know what this is called? This was the American plan in order to bring aid to Europe. The Marshall Plan. Yes. You have that in your book, in your notes? That's the part we're following along. Now, and the general, his name is George Marshall. That's him right here. He is trying to say what? Come on, Sam, it's up to us again. To do what? Save Europe again. It's up to us again to save Europe. Now, how are they saving Europe?
Giving them money.
Giving them money, right? We're rebuilding this house that's in shambles. Now, oh, but what's the cartoonist, the point they're trying to make? Not just that they're just building them because they can't help themselves. You see, self-help is not going to do it. That's what that phrase says, self-help. So, the point being, the cartoonist is saying, it's not for Europe's sake. Ooh, tell me why. Yeah, I like that. Can you expand? Anybody expand on that? Something to do with American trade? You're on?
Maybe allies against the Soviets?
Yeah. We're kind of going around on this. How would it help the United States? Helping Europe is going to help the U.S. More what?
Circulate money.
More allies. More, what's that?
Circulate money.
Sure, yeah. That's somebody that I could buy and sell with. And ultimately, what is the U.S. shopping around to everybody right now? What are we trying to sell them after the war?
Capitalism.
Democracy. Capitalism. Because guess who else is, who's the salesman right behind me who's trying to sell his stuff? Right, so that's the thing. We want to spread our belief system throughout the world. It's in our best interest because now here's the thing. What would happen? What's the cartoonist's point? What's going to happen if they fail? What's the cartoon in the cartoon? What's it going to say? And where's it going to collapse? How does the cartoonist overestimate the damage that's going to be caused?
Up in the glass.
Yes, because what kind of, where's it going to land?
Right
on the greenhouse that's made of glass. How fragile the United States is. If we let even a little bit fall from Western Europe, there's going to be some damage, some hardcore damage to the American system. So it is in our own self-interest to protect Europe because we want them to be democracies and be capitalists as well, okay? And this is the Marshall Plan. Interesting, this is the Marshall Plan from two perspectives, two different points of view. Whose point of view is over on my side?
That's America. That's America, that's the Russian.
Whoa, that's correct. Why?
Because that...
Stalin
playing basketball.
Winning
the basketball game?
He's not winning.
Stalin's trying to take it away.
He's trying to stop it, right? Marshall Plan means a score for economic recovery. And what's Stalin trying to do? Trying to stop that, right? Is he going to do it? No. And if he did, it'd be goaltending. You got to count it anyway.
But wouldn't he want economic recovery?
What's that?
Wouldn't he want economic recovery, though?
No. Well, yeah, he wants economic recovery, but he wants to provide it. Right, not for the Marshall Plan. He'd like to see Europe turn to him for help.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Because on this side, so Marshall Plan equals, yay, that's a point for European recovery. And he's trying to stop it. He wants to stop the Marshall Plan. Why? Because this is what the Soviets think. This is another, hey, if you see the cigar and the big whatever, this isn't like the Monopoly guy, but the same thing. This is the big fat cat industrialist.
They made him look.
Yeah, he's got stars on his hat, and he looks like a wealthy guy who's abusing the system.
He's got the money sign with the cigar smoke.
He's got the money sign coming out of the smoke, and he is sitting on Europe, crushing it under his own weight. Okay, the Marshall Plan, they're saying, is really designed for the United States. They're just gobbling up, right? They're just turning into a new imperial power. They're gobbling them up economically because they're saying it's just like what they did in Latin America. America's become an economic imperialist, and that's what the Soviets are saying. They're just crushing them. Yeah.
So Stalin didn't want the Marshall Plan because he wanted to be the one to bring.
Yes. And they felt that what the Americans are doing, they're just taking over Europe. Okay. Both sides saw the same thing. They're both trying to take over, and both were. Both sides. That's what they were doing. So now this is the Marshall Plan in work. Here, how ironic is it that, guess what? Who blew up that bridge?
They did.
What?
That's
Ah! Yes.
So
I wanted that bad.
Hello? Oh, you, are you serious?
What?
It's for you. No, what was that?
Just leave that there and watch the video.
Prank phone
calls.
You know when people do that? When they call?
Prank calls. It's like, you don't hear anything, and you're like, hello? And then you just don't respond because they're scared. What?
No. And we're back. So who blew this up?
USA.
And who built it? Yes, we blew it up, and then the U.S. rebuilds it. Because it's all in the bit, right? We'll blow up your stuff, but now we want to rebuild. Because if not, the place would be in ruins. Here's a great example. German city of Stuttgart, you can see, wiped out, right? In the bombing by the Allies. And now, 10 years, I think 10 years like that, from 1947 to 1955. Okay? This is West, yeah. Good point. This is, we're going to talk about the difference between Western Europe and Eastern Europe. But yeah, look at the rebuilding there. And guess what? The Marshall Plan works. A lot of comparisons have been done with Iraq. What did we do? We won the war. We overthrew Saddam. And then we tried to do the rebuilding of Iraq. You could imagine if we, after World War II, if we would have walked out of Europe, war-torn, what would happen to Europe? They'd be in still some bad times. That's what happened after World War I, right? Yeah. All the problems led to World War II, so the United States wants to be there to help out. And so we, after World War II, the United States occupies Japan, takes control there, also controls, helps rebuild Europe. So we're trying to do, that's what we were trying to do in Iraq. The problem was, there's a lot of people there who don't want us anymore. That's what the insurgency is in Iraq, is they're trying to say, get out now. At what point do we ultimately get out? Guess what, have we even left Germany?
Yeah, they're
Germany, but guess what? We have American bases in Germany. Yes, American bases there.
Japan,
Japan
American bases
as well.
In Korea.
Yes, we got a lot of places.
Right? Where else?
So now, in this period of Europe's
rebuilding,
they realized we went to war with each other, one, we went to war with each other in World War II. Let's don't go to war with each other. United Nations is going to help with that, but you know what? Let's now come together, because if we're going to rebuild ourselves economically, we got to deal with some of our issues. Let's now kind of become a community. They call themselves, there's a lot of different names. European market, common market, European community, blah, blah, blah. Nowadays, we call them the EU. Stands for what?
European Union.
The EU. So they are no, but, and they're in this weird sort of, what do you call them? They're not a country. It's not the United States of Europe. Why would it not be the United States of Europe? What would they give up on? What's that? Yes, because if you are all one country, hey, you know what? We should have one language, one
currency.
One currency. Oh, what the EU does. We'll talk about
Europe.
That in a second.
Oh, yeah.
One language, one common sense, right? We're one identity. And the Europeans want to be together. This is an interesting, never really seen before. They're coming together economically, but not politically and nationally, right? And so we still see this, the creation of this. Here's an example. Ultimately, what will happen with Europe? Are they going to become unified?
Well, they have the same currency.
Yeah, so what is erasing? What is the euro? Yeah, and this cartoonist is saying, you know what? The euro, this, you can see here, this currency is what's it doing? It's erasing these national lines.
Except for England.
Yeah, we're going to get to them in a second. Yeah, the British aren't part of this. Because now what's on your currency? If you pull it out, there's only two things of real value on there. The number, 1, 20, 100, right? That tells you how much it's worth. Serial number, right? Besides that, you know what your money's filled with? Nationalistic what?
Symbols,
imagery, right? Photos of famous dead guys, pictures of famous places, and symbols, right? You got the eye, you got the, what you call it? And she's got a 20 euro over there, nice. Okay, what's interesting now, what do you do with the euro? Because they still want to put symbols on there, but now you gotta get something from everybody, okay? Your money is filled with symbols. American Eagle, right? All that sort of stuff. All that sort of stuff.
Right? It's more.
It's like almost twice.
Yeah.
So now, guess who's not part of this, Georgie? Who's not part of the common currency?
Okay.
So here we have a cartoon of a guy. Looks like Charles de Gaulle, a French guy, and they're trying to break down this tariff wall of taxes because, hey, a common currency is great because you don't have to change your money, but you know what else? Let's don't tax each other. Because if you tax somebody, it means you don't want to trade as much.
Yep.
Did you hear what happened yesterday?
No.
California sales tax?
Yeah.
Oh, went up.
Oh, yeah.
Went up an entire percent.
Wow. Nice.
Yes.
At the end of the month.
That every time you buy something, it is 1% more now.
What?
Wow.
Oh my God.
If you want to buy yourself a flat screen TV, it's going to start being more, right? Because why? Because the California economy has been, is in bad shape, so California's trying to raise more funds. What is that going to make some people do? You know what? Taxes are high. I may not buy. So here we have Europe saying, let's get rid of taxes between each other. Hey, if you want to sell to Russia, the United States, or whatever, yeah, we'll tax them. But you know, between each other, let's make us do better. So they say get rid of taxes. And here they are trying to coax the one country that was kind of resistant towards joining this whole thing. Who's that in the bottom right corner? Britannia, right? Here it is again. The six European powers, and they're like coming together, and here's the British Prime Minister trying to pull his country over, but limited by this unwillingness to join. Because guess what? Are we willing to get rid of our money? We started this a little bit in the 90s. We said, you know what? Let's make us a continent over there. Canada, United States, and Mexico, let's not tax each other anymore. Great, make good, because Canada's our number one trading partner. Mexico we trade a whole bunch with. So let's make us all do better between each other. Let's get rid of that. Since we're North America, let's make trade free and make this an agreement. And we know what it's called? NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement. We know what we call that? NAFTA. It's called NAFTA. Have you ever heard of NAFTA? NAFTA is created in the 90s, this idea of trying for the North American countries to have free trade with each other. To try to facilitate that. Now the issues there, same as the same national issues always come out. Oh, I don't want to do that. Mexicans are going to take my job. And oh, I don't want to do this. Okay. Now what if we just say, you know, one currency? Let's don't have the peso and the American dollar and the Canadian currency. Let's just all have one. Instantly, you'll have a lot of people nationalistic fervor saying, you know what? I don't want to take Abraham Lincoln off my $5 bill. Right. I want to keep my stuff on me because it's part of my country. Yes.
I was just going to say that in some places in England, they accept euros, but, like, it's rare.
Yeah, interesting. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I know that there's still power, but what places do accept euros?
Well, it's like, or when I was in England, well, we were in, like, Tunbridge Wells, which is kind of, like, a suburban type place, but then there's little markets, like, little stands where some people take euros. I mean, probably because they're not from England or they're just there selling stuff trying to get, like, I remember one little place was selling like bracelets or something, and they accepted euros because the guy was Spanish. So basically just going to England, selling the bracelets, going back to Spain using the euros.
Yeah. And you'll see that too if you travel to Europe. A lot of places will take American dollars.
Yeah.
The places that are taking American dollars are the places that tourists are going to.
Yeah.
Because they know, I'm much more willing to spend an American dollar because I don't have to get the transfer. Well, you know what I mean? So, all right. Now, that's all what's happening in Western Europe. The Marshall Plan, rebuilding, coming together. Now, on the East, something's happening. What's happening in the East side? They're becoming part of who? Yes, because here they are, all these countries, these newly independent countries, watch what happens. Ka-chonk, ka-chonk, ka-chonk. Whoa. Stalin says, I need to have, he makes all them part of this. Now, he doesn't take them as part of the Soviet Union. He puts his economic rebuilding over there. And you know what? And he called, we refer to them as something else. What do you, if you got Jupiter and all those things that fly around, what are all those things called? But more technical term though. Satellites, right? A satellite can't exist without its the mother country, okay? And so all of these will be known as satellite countries. And we call them satellites because without the Soviet Union, they're nothing. They're not independent. Or they technically are, but you know who's really controlling the Soviet Union? They're kind of like a puppet regime, okay? And there's that line, you ready? Magic line, boom. Separates the two of them. That line, by the way, folks, does not exist. There is no physical line there. People get this line confused. What do we know what we call that line? Hold on a second.
Is it a river?
There's nothing there.
Oh.
Okay. This line separates the Eastern Europe from Western Europe.
Really?
The capitalism on the West, democracies, the satellite countries, communist countries on the East. This line, though, has always kind of been there. Check this one out. This is chapter 6. Oh, change over time. Guess what? What line was this?
Alexander.
Some of you are thinking, oh, I have to remember all the old stuff now.
I know.
What happened to the Roman Empire?
It
split.
East and west.
Yes, it splits between east and west. Who splits it? It becomes, yeah, Constantine, right? Constantine moves over. Another guy earlier, Diocletian, split it. Constantine moved to Constantinople. And ever since then, we have, what is that eastern side called, by the way?
Byzantine.
Starts with a B, ends in Byzantine?
Byzantine.
The Byzantine Empire and the Western Roman Empire. And ever since then, there has been a difference between Eastern Europe and Western Europe. I don't have it here, but I'm going to include it in the PowerPoint later. You'll see. I'm going to put some really interesting graphics of economically what Western Europe is as a this is Winston Churchill, and he gives this thing, this line, a name called the Iron Curtain, which we all call it that. Let's listen to him.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. And all these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only the Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow. This is certainly not the liberated Europe we fought to build up, nor is it one which contains the essentials of permanent peace.
What's that?
I
played you a couple from Churchill. Yes, they're all. I played you several from the same person.
No, but I mean, it's like other guys. Like they're.
They all sound like Winston Churchill.
Yeah,
they
all sound like Winston.
Anyway, he calls this the Iron Curtain. Okay, and behind that Iron Curtain lies what?
The
communist countries that were taken over. Does he think the Iron Curtain is a good thing?
No.
No, he thinks this is a bad thing. Okay. Hold on a second. Put that on. Yeah, he sees it as this. Okay. This big old wall that blocks out Europe. We don't know what's going on in Eastern Europe because they're controlled by Stalin and the communists. Yeah.
People
being crushed by this, right? They're split down. This is not the plans that they set for permanent peace. Okay? The Russians are saying, oh, don't fence me in. It's like, actually, you're the ones doing this, though, okay? Now, by the way, though, let me emphasize this. Kids get this messed up. There is no wall. There's no fence. Okay? This is not an actual physical thing. There will be one in Berlin, a physical wall. Iron Curtain and Berlin Wall are different things. One is through a city. The Iron Curtain is all of Eastern Europe behind this figurative, not real, curtain, okay? Now, who was that old guy? That old guy was Winston Churchill, okay? Interesting, Winston Churchill, by the way, is voted out of office. Here's this guy who leads, I know, how do you lead your motivating prime minister, the guy who's your hero, and then after the war, they're like, excellent, vote, all right, you're out, next guy. A lot of them saw him as a war guy. Okay, and in times of war, what happens after war? We had a Republican, vote for a Democrat. After a Democrat, vote for a Republican. That's what they did. They got rid of their Republican, conservative, that's what he was, and voted in somebody from their Democratic called the Labor Party. But guess what? He's voted back in years later, 1951.
Oh my
Okay, he's an interesting character there. There's a statue of him. Yeah, he was a little hunched over, sure. Okay. Right there next to Big Ben. Interesting, you know what Big Ben is? That's not Big Ben.
What is it?
You know what Big Ben is?
The
actual
clock
itself.
The actual what itself?
The clock.
No. It's something. It's the actual. It's the bell. Yeah, it's Big Ben is the name of the bell inside of it.
Oh, I didn't get your question. All right.
Yeah, not the whole clock tower itself. Not the clock tower.
I know it's part
of it. Yeah. Ding ding. All right. So, USSR in this Iron Curtain is going to take over all of this. They begin to do the same thing they did in Eastern Europe that they did to themselves. Collectivized agriculture, set up a secret police, and they're going to, United States bad, Soviet Union good. Okay. Now, in response to this, Truman, the president, says, you know what? We're not going to invade Moscow. We're not going to invade the USSR because that's war. But every time after, so they've taken over all these satellite countries, and the United States says, we don't want them taken over anymore. And they make a plan. Truman says, you know what? Anytime they go a new place, if communism tries to spread someplace else, we're going to do what to it? We're going to contain it. So if you have your notes out, I would highlight or underline one word associated with the Truman Doctrine called containment. Don't attack communism, but to do what to it? Stop it from spreading. I'm going to keep it locked in where it is. Contain communism. So when communism rears its head up in Korea, what would the United States do? Go to war there. We'll try to contain it from spreading. When it happens in Vietnam, containment. When it happens in Afghanistan, let's don't go to war, because that means we've gone to war against the Soviets. Let's fund the Afghans, give them weapons and training to try to contain it there as well. Containment, Truman's doctrine.
NATO.
So like you're asking, all these things that Jackie said are all part of the Cold War, all these events and all these alliances. So this is, remember I said causes of World War I, alliances? Here's a big alliance. North Atlantic Treaty Organization. And the countries there are all these Western democracies. United States, Britain are the big ones, France, Canada, all that. You can see in the map over there, all those that circle the North Atlantic Ocean, all are part of this.
What's the difference between this one and NAFTA, though?
NAFTA is a modern, that's in the 1990s.
Okay.
And that was just Canada, U.S., and Mexico, free trade. This is alliance. If somebody invaded Canada, guess what? The United States will protect them. If somebody invades France, we're all going to protect you. We're all going to protect you. Okay, because we know we're all frightened of the Russians. And the Russians say, hey, you can't do that. That's alliances. And alliances is going to cause war. And so that's what he's yelling at them. You're circling me. You're a warmonger. A warmonger is somebody who's advocating war. Great name to call somebody on the playground, by the way.
Warmonger.
Hey, give me that pizza. Give it back to me, you warmonger. And they'll pause for a second. You know, and then you get your pizza back. Right? And then they'll have to ask their friend, like, did he insult me? How dare you ask me that question, you warmonger? Pause. Yeah. Anyway, and so what will he do in return? He's going to make his own alliance. Now, the cartoonist is joking about this because they're not encircling him. The cartoonist is saying that they're using their alliance for what? Protection. Anybody look at the barbed wire? Ooh, I thought that was very true. It's an Atlantic pact, yeah. So we kind of wrote it in barbed wire.
Oh, lovely.
You see that? And there's all those Western democracies lumping themselves together. So in response, he creates, what does he create?
They're not even like circling him though.
I know,
like,
yeah. So
they're big and they're just kind of like.
But what's that? They create the Warsaw Pact. So the two alliances, NATO versus the Warsaw Pact. And you can see it's split. See that Iron Curtain line? Mm-hmm. Right there. There's the Iron Curtain.
So the Warsaw Pact was to benefit the Soviet Union?
The Warsaw Pact was the official name of the Soviet Union gobbling up all these countries. They say, oh, we're all just part of the same alliance. But really, they're controlled by, and like Churchill said, they're under some part of direct control from Moscow. The guys there were often like a puppet. Yes?
Why isn't Ireland a part of this?
The yellow countries didn't want any part of this. Okay. Neutral countries. Like, we're going to... non-aligned. Yeah, we're going to talk about it. A lot of these countries just don't want to get involved in this.
But is Ireland still not involved? Is it still neutral?
Yeah, for the most part. I mean, they're part of the UN, but these alliances have fallen apart since the collapse of the Soviet Union.
Is Switzerland a part of the UN?
No, part of the UN.
No,
wait, UN. UN, I think so. Yeah, most of the countries are involved in the UN, but they were never—they've never been any sort of a political alliance or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they see themselves. They pride their neutrality as, you know, very important to them, and they benefited from it.
They have the great banks.
The map.
Whoa.
This is Santa Claus map, right? Because every time you get a map, you always put yourself right in the middle.
What the?
Yeah, that'll wake you up, huh, Jeffrey?
Like,
yes, let's look at a map from the polar region.
Oh, it's so
yeah,
so
you're looking at it from Santa's house. Okay. So when we say it's U.S. versus USSR, like, hey, that's a long way to get to the Soviet Union. Check it. Not if you go, ooh, you go a different direction. Why do you always have to go left and right? I can just go this way.
This is gonna
right?
Mess me
up.
Ooh,
that what?
This is gonna
ooh,
mess me up.
That's
so
why,
much.
Oh my goodness,
yeah,
that confused. Who struggles with maths?
No, oh yeah, now it makes sense for Alaska being part of Russia before.
Yeah, Alaska used to be part of Russia. That totally makes sense,
yeah,
right?
Before I'm like, what are you talking about? It's like way over here.
Yeah. I see
that
from my house.
Oh, man, that's really interesting.
So,
did you? So what's going to happen is that you're going to want to be able to attack the other guy just in case. In case the United States gets attacked, we should be able to, right? If one of our allies gets attacked, we need to attack them. So now let's build missiles. Because you know what we used to have? Remember when we dropped on Japan? The atomic bomb. But we had to do this. Fly, open up, bomb drops. The bomb detonates before it hits the ground to create more of a spread of its damage, but now we don't do that anymore. You don't need to fly over. Now we've taken missiles. Now you put your missile in your country, shoot it all the way over. Same thing. Before it hits the ground, the top opens up, a bomb explodes. Okay? Now, but the missiles don't go that far. So it's interesting. One of the positive effects from the Cold War is missile technology. Why is that going to be a good thing? Space. That gets us to the moon. That puts that little robot, who we put, Wally, we sent him to Mars, right?
That movie is, Wally. No, he's not sent to Mars.
Yeah, he is.
No,
he's that little robot? Wally's on Mars right now, isn't
he? No,
he's not. You're talking about the other robot.
Yeah, the real robot, the Martian, the rover. The
land. We sent to Mars.
Yeah. What's that? Anyway, we sent, but we're able to do all these things.
That's what I was.
Now look, so if you're the United States, it's a simple shot. Hey, you go ask Canada, can we put a bunch of missiles? Hey, you go ask Denmark, can we put some of your missiles in Greenland? Right, so as soon as the shot hits, then we can shoot at them from there. They can shoot at us from here. You know what's interesting about the North Pole? There's ice there. You just can't see it because that's Antarctic is land. The Arctic is just sheets of ice. So guess what you can have over there? Yes, submarines. Now, if the Germans ruled the seas in World War I with their U-boats, the Lusitania and all that, who's going to control the oceans in the Cold War?
Russia.
Us, yes. And we still have that monopoly. We have the ability to kind of, this is bizarre, we can hear underwater using sonar. We are able to know all the submarines that are out there. We have the technology, and they don't have the technology to really know where we're at. And this is going to scare you a little bit, but rest assured that if we were attacked, and you will have 10 minutes until all major cities are going to be destroyed in a nuclear holocaust, guess what? That feels terrible, but you know what? We have enough subs out there. Well, what does a submarine have? Well, guess what? The submarines happen to have what?
Silos.
They have silos. They can launch missiles. Lots of them. Okay. They can launch missiles from underwater. And nobody knows where we're at, so we can pull up right next to wherever we want them to go. Say, hey, by the way, we're going to die in about 10 minutes. Why don't you go over to Moscow, Beijing, and all the other cities, and why don't you launch missiles? And we know that we can retaliate. That is ultimately why nobody shoots them at us. Okay, and we're going to talk about that. This is a crazy or a mad way to think about it. We'll be right back.
Each Ohio-class sub is manned by two rotating crews, allowing the boat to spend up to 80% of its time at sea. The sub's reactor can power all systems for 9 years without refueling. And it can remain completely submerged for up to a year.
170, coming to 160.
In the event of a nuclear exchange, she is very survivable because she can't be located, unlike fixed land-based sites or aircraft that are flying in the air that can be tracked by radar.
All right, now looking at, I showed you this map before, and I wanted you to look at all these countries in Africa that got independent, but all those red dots are what?
Hot spots
or warm spots. Cold War never got hot. It got warm. The places that were there, they would probably call it hot. Okay, and I'm talking about five of them. I only count four.
Russia.
Because there's actually two. There's two right here. We're going to talk about Berlin. So there's going to be two issues. Of all the different sort of conflicts that happen, there's a lot of them. I'm only going to focus on five. Sort of the biggies. Two that happened in Berlin, Cuba, Korea, and Vietnam. Okay? So let's look here at Germany, focusing on Berlin. So now, Germany has been blamed kind of again for World War II, right? Nazis, right? They're blamed for World War I. Now all the countries say, you know what? We need to make sure Germany doesn't do it again. And also we need to rebuild them. So each of the winners, you're all going to get a section, and you're in charge of rebuilding them. Okay? You can set up your own economic systems and all that other stuff. Well, those three democracies, they want to do democracy. And they say, you know what? Let's just put them together, since we're all democracies. So now we have a west of, don't look at this map right here. They're close. Look at the one on that side. You're going to have a Soviet zone, or a communist, and a western zone ruled by the British, French, and the Americans. And that's on the east side. This is on the west side. So that'll be known as East Germany, West Germany. Okay? There is no line that separates the two of them. There is no physical border that separates East and West Germany, because East and Germany are countries. Now, do you see this city, the capital of Germany?
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, Berlin. Now, Germany was one country, so now they separate it and it becomes two totally separate countries. The city of Berlin, the capital, is going to be a mirror image of what happened to the country. That's what this map is. Let's take the city and divide that into half. East Berlin and West Berlin. So now, if you're West Berlin, you're a democracy. Half of your city is a capitalist democracy. Surrounded by an entire Eastern German communist country. You are an island in the middle of a sea of a different ideology. Yes.
Why are you splitting Berlin? It's covered in Soviet.
That's an excellent question.
Yeah, why?
You want to research that?
Wait, who decided?
Berlin was the heart of Germany.
Who did that?
All of them. This is what happens when you...
The democracy do that?
This is what happens when you got four... When you have people trying to come up with a compromise. Hey, make it... Hey, it should be communist. No. This is Berlin. That's too important. You can't make it communist. It should be...
in the communist part.
I know. But they didn't want to give in.
I know, that
this is
what
this is.
So
this is often the failure of compromise, right? You, when you say, "Oh, hey, I want to play with a dolly," and you're like, "Oh, I want to play with a dolly." Hey, compromise. Let's cut it in half. Guess what? Compromise doesn't always work, right? Because compromise makes some silly things. And as Jen's pointing out, it's pretty ridiculous to cut a city in half that's completely surrounded, you know, in East Germany. All right, so this creates the first conflict, known as the Berlin Blockade. Also known as the Berlin Airlift.
Wait. Okay, so which side was where was the wall? Who got the worst part of the wall? Berlin, West Berlin? Or East?
We haven't got to the wall yet. The wall isn't created originally. The wall is going to come here.
Oh, so it goes all
the way.
This is the city over here. That's the country.
So this is the exact same way.
The exact same way. So, I know it's ridiculous, right?
So the wall, where is the wall
right here.
People in?
To what?
I'll
show you another map in a second. Okay.
It's not like enclosing.
All right. So now here's Stalin. Stalin thinks this is ridiculous.
Yeah.
And Stalin wants to get West Berlin. Like Jim was saying, why it should just be part of Eastern Europe. And Stalin says it should. And you know what? That's a good little ha ha. I won without going to war. I don't want to invade West Berlin because the Americans and the French and the British are going to fight me. So I want West Berlin to come be part of us. So you're going to use a technique that many people have used in the past, starve them out.
Oh.
Okay, I'm going to make a blockade. Napoleon tried to do it. We saw the same thing in World War II. Okay, and he's going to say, you know what? West Berlin, you can be whatever you want to be. Oh, but since I control East Germany, nobody can use our roads or our trains to come into here. So you can see, roads closed, the rails closed, so they are now totally blocked out of the rest of the world, and they have no supplies. You're going to run out of food and water, and then as soon as they starve, they say, fine, we give in. Great, you're part of East Germany. Woo, we won the First World War. But the United States says, I'm not going to let that happen. Because you block those two, but which way can I go? You see the cartoon? Which way can they go?
Yeah.
They can fly over the top, right? So this is the first, important here, is the first test of wills between the East and the West. The United States is going to fly in, and the other allies as well, we're going to fly in supplies every day.
Oh my God.
For, can you find the exact date? A year, just over a year. How long the Berlin airlift lasted?
That's forever.
Yes. You can find the details, like how many flights went. It's pretty amazing how many thousands of flights went. Every day, flights are coming in and out. Okay. Stalin's excited about this because he feels it's a game of cat and mouse, and he's got the Western powers. You can see all these guys. He's just—he's not killing the mouse, is he? He's just playing with it. He's toying with it, but he's in control. The landing and all that. So here's a plane flying in. You got kids. The supplies they're bringing in. You got kids playing a game of, you know, literally the planes would land. The guys would get out, they'd dump all their stuff off, and, you know, they're famous for bringing, like, candy, throwing candy out to the kids, and, you know, sort of seen as this, you know, a symbol of hope and freedom to the West Berliners, who knew that they didn't have enough coal and supplies, okay? And in many ways, this is the kind of conflict that it turns out to be. Two guys fighting with toothpicks. Two giants, right? You can see here, I like how the cartoonist juxtaposes or compares, puts gigantic people in a small city and then gives them itty bitty weapons to show how small of a conflict this is. No one's going to get hurt in this conflict, but it's a big battle. Ideologically it is. Yes, Jamie?
278,000 total flights Berlin at the height of the airlift, one plane for each West Berlin every 30 seconds.
Every 30 seconds. At the height.
At the height.
At the height. So planes were just coming in.
Well, that's nice.
Would that be nighttime too?
Great.
No. At the height. They were saying at certain time periods that planes were just constantly landing. It's a short flight, but you know what I mean?
But still, 270,000.
In less than a year.
Where was the planes flying
from? Like you saw on the map here, they're all throughout Europe. They're flying from Germany.
Why don't they come from the U.S.?
No, but from America. Remember, America's the West are controlling these areas. So they're not flying from New York.
So it's like U.S. sponsored?
Yes.
Okay.
Now, why doesn't Stalin do anything about it? He's sitting there, he's watching these planes fly over him. Here, they're storks. Why does the cartoonist use a stork? What does the stork bring?
Life.
Ah, say that again.
Life
cereal is really good. I love life cereal. Oh, have you tried maple and brown sugar? Oh, to die for. By the way, banana nut Cheerios went out and bought them. Love them. I am, seriously, I know I'm a grown man, but... And I feel just, some ways I feel like I'm 16 and I just want to meet and a bowl of cereal and I'm going to win.
The best cereal is Golden Grahams. I haven't
had them in a long time.
No, they're so good.
That's the problem with life. You got to eat it fast. It's not a sit down and think about it because you get the sauce.
We should all bring them.
For our Super Saturday.
Yeah.
Hey, I forgot. Why is Stalin not shooting these birds of life?
Because
he doesn't want to
weigh it out.
He knows if he shoots them, what's going to happen?
War.
Yes, exactly. The birds will drop bombs. Which you don't want to see happen. I was walking with, I remember J.J. Hardy was walking with him and he's... I was in high school freshman year, and we're walking, and he got the biggest bomb landed on him. Because we had, this is Southern California, so there's a lot of seagulls. I mean, at lunch, holy moly. And JJ got hit, splat, went here.
Oh!
Wow. Anyway, okay. Oh, can you believe it? Stalin finally dies. It took a long time to happen. We learned about totalitarianism, Russian Revolution, World War II, Cold War, and he dies. Okay. And here's who's his successor? Khrushchev. You learned about Khrushchev. Tell me what you think about the audio track. Raise your hand first off if you took a walk. That's it? I'm sorry, who left their computer to listen to it? Okay. And what'd you think?
I liked it. I put it on my iPhone.
I liked the track. It twice.
Nice. And what do you think about the audio track?
I thought it was interesting.
Very long.
I like that. Good. A documentary without pictures.
I couldn't really understand what they were saying sometimes when they were talking in Russian.
Now, what were some of the things you learned from that? Some of you people just wrote some things down. Okay, I didn't have to answer those questions. What were some of the things that I wrote about it? Josh?
That his son, after like all his opposition in the U.S., his son becomes a American.
Isn't that amazing? His son is an American citizen and professor at what, Brown University, I think?
Yeah. Rebelling, I think.
Children want to rebel against the parents.
Yeah. Khrushchev, now why is this speech secret?
He was basically like bashing Stalin. Well, not like bashing him, but like saying all the stuff that he did wrong. And like people, he isn't supposed to talk about that because it's like a big secret.
Yes.
Even though it was like a huge thing, and I don't know.
So who does he want to keep it a secret from?
The Stalin supporters.
Stalin supporters and from the West. He doesn't really want the United States to know, right? Because they want the West to see us as, we're perfect, we don't question or whatever, but from behind the scenes, he's saying, hey, we probably need to change some of those stuff, okay? And so here's the West. How do you take Khrushchev? It looks like he's melted, and melted in terms of politics is what, a good thing?
No.
Yeah, it's kind of a good thing. Like, hey, this guy's a this big old ice sheet of ice, and he's warming up a little bit to us, okay? And the West are like, there's Britain, France, and the U.S. are like, hey, he's warming up a little bit. He's got kind of a scary smile. But underneath, hey, how does he feel about Germany? No change. He's still a big old imposing iceberg underneath the water, okay? Now, how will we perceive him? We see him two different ways. We see him as, first off, the Nikita Khrushchev who made a statement says, we will bury you. Now, I don't know about you, but you could take that as a death threat, okay? If some country says, we'll bury you, you could be saying, oh, I guess they're not coming to our party, right? Yeah. What's that? He does mean it. That's what it said in the audio track, right? Economically, and he says, oh, ultimately, I mean you're going to bury yourselves with your economic theories. But it comes across as a bad thing. Here's a statement he has. If anyone believes that our smiles involve the abandonment of the teachings of Marx, Engels, and Lenin, he deceives himself. For those who wait for that must wait until a shrimp learns to whistle.
Ooh.
Which means that we talk about, you're going to wait until pigs fly. Guess what? The pig's never going to fly. So he's saying, if you think we're at all going to abandon communist teaching, not going to happen.
They don't know.
Don't think that just because I'm not Stalin, that it's still not, you know, we're still business as usual. Anybody see this here? Now, this is a great story about Khrushchev. Yeah, he's at the UN. Good point. And what's on his desk?
A shoe.
Yes, what was the story of the shoe on the audio track they talked about?
He was like slapping him in the face with his shoe.
Verbally slapping him in the face with his shoe.
As our image is revealed, we find ourselves in New York City in October of 1960. Inside the UN General Assembly, Nikita Khrushchev is pounding his shoe and his fists, interrupting a special conference on third world decolonization. This outburst quickly overshadows the purpose of the conference and forever remains a petulant symbol of communist defiance in an age of superpower hostility.
In each period of time, you have their own image, and this image belonged to the Cold War. It was a very good image of the enemy, that banging the shoes, very unusual. My father decided that if the American say that can do everything what they want, he decided that he will bring all the world leaders to the United States, the United Nations, to discuss decolonization.
Khrushchev intended to press for greater freedom for Africa from Western powers. But a speech by British Prime Minister Harold Macmillan, deriding communist colonization of Eastern Europe, quickly set off Khrushchev's loud outburst. The Soviet leader later gives a speech railing against the West and is quoted in the media as saying, "I will bury you."
It became such legend, which of course was also very different, and he never told that he will bury Americans.
In reality, what he did say can be more closely translated as a promise that communism will outlast capitalism. Yet the world would remember this mistranslated threat to bury the West, and the image of the Soviet premier banging his shoe. Khrushchev had hurt only himself, and he knew it.
He spoke, and after he banged his shoe and he saw, then he has his feeling that he went too far.
Khrushchev is this guy. He's this loud, sort of an overly animated, a term is often referred to as bombastic. He's this imposing character. But on the other side, like you saw in the secret speech, he is also seen as, hey, he's kicking, getting rid of, here's Stalin being kicked out of USSR. And it's hard to see, but on the cuff of his pant leg says Khrushchev. He's getting rid of the old.
Where
did you say that? I have no idea.
Oh, his foot real tiny. Oh,
that was Trotsky.
Oh, okay.
All the old ways with the new thing coming in.
That's all there.
But now here comes the problem for Khrushchev. Here's the city, and it's shut, and they said one sector's west, one sector's east. People on the east realize that, hey, they got Levi's and Nikes. Not those goods, but I'm saying life is better on the west. There's better jobs, there's better consumer goods, they got toasters and things like that. Let's call our local realtor and let's move across town. And they're starting to see a wave of migration of people moving from east to west. And people start to say, if you're the east, it doesn't look good that people are leaving your town. So what's a good way to stop people from moving, Olivia?
Run up a wall.
What's that? You build a wall. The Chinese try to do it to stop people from coming in. They're trying to do the opposite.
Keep people from leaving.
So almost overnight, you have this happen. They lay down some barbed wire, okay? Then the process of them building a wall like this, okay? People start to freak out and say, oh, this means that, guess what? If you build it through a city, hey, grandma's on that side, Uncle Ted's on that side. Some people are like, okay, we need to quickly get over, okay? Some people, you can see here, walls cut through buildings, and people are going in a building on one side, trying to climb out on the other side to go from east to west. This looks bad for the Soviets, for the communism, that people are fleeing. People start to get shot. People try to escape across the wall. Okay, this is what it looks like. A better zoom in look here, as West Berlin is going to be cut off. Okay, there's different gates that you can get through, and it's completely walled off throughout. If you want to get into it, out of. You are locked in, literally. Okay?
Wait.
This is an amazing story. I'm going to put a really interesting story. I don't think you guys watch in geography. Anybody see the guy who tried to drive?
No.
Shit. Yeah, I don't have time to show that. This is a really fun video if you want to watch it.
Turn his car into go from Cuba to
No, this is here. So I'm going to put a fun video, it's only about 6-7 minutes, fun one if you want to be able to watch it, on our blog about a guy who does it successfully, gets across from east to west Berlin via a car.
Okay. Wait, go back to that map. I'm trying to see, but where's the wall?
The red line.
Red thing.
Yeah, so why didn't they go out the back?
These are all, see the barbed wire? It's all locked in.
Oh, why is the west blocked in? I thought it was the east that was blocked in so that the... so that they can go over
so
the west side.
So that you just can't do this? Like that?
Oh, yeah. So then why they just walk out?
They can't. So they're a wall keeping them out.
On that side. They don't care if they go.
They don't care. That's all east of Germany.
The west side.
That's a country land. Why does you go walk out of the country and come this way? So you got to build a wall around the whole thing.
Why don't you just walk out and leave?
No, you're all still in East. You're all still in communism.
Yeah,
you're all still in
East.
No. Basically, you're locking West Germany in.
Is West good?
Yeah. West was being successful, yes.
Okay, but then if they locked in the West, I thought then what's the point of
putting up the wall because I thought that they wanted the people from the east not to go over into
yes.
the west.
Yeah, there's a wall.
Yeah.
So the people from the west can't leave either?
No, they can't. But they have planes, so they let them go.
Yes.
Oh, okay, so they're locked. Oh, yeah, and wasn't the destruction in 1989?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, well...
We'll explain it later.
This is
now, the U.S. is going to react poorly and say, hey, this is terrible. Now, in the 1960s, Kennedy's going to visit West Berlin. He can fly in. And he flies in and he says, you know what? He sees this just like the first Berlin issue. This is a key moment. A moment where I don't want to lose. And I want the people of Berlin to know that I'm with you. Not just America, but me personally. Okay? And here is, this is interesting. That is actually his handwriting. That's a, that's the end of his speech. Okay, this is a fame. This is his famous speech. That he wants to tell the people of Germany in German, I'm not an American citizen right now. The best statement you can say in the world is, I'm a Berliner. I'm with you. I'm a citizen of Berlin. Ich bin ein Berliner. Okay, and he, interesting is that he sounds it out phonetically. Okay, like Ich is I-C-H and he writes I-S-H because he's trying to do the, trying to make it sound as German as possible. And he compares this to what do you think the best statement you could say 2,000 years before was? To be a citizen of what?
Romans.
Of the Romans. So in the past it used to be, I'm a Roman. Now he's saying, you know what? The best thing that anybody could say is, I'm a Berliner. Let's listen to him.
2,000 years ago, the proudest Polish wars, Civis Romanus Sum. Today, in the world of freedom, the proudest post is Ich bin ein Berliner.
He's a Berliner. He's a people of West Berlin.
There are some who say that communism is the wave of the future. Let them come to Berlin.
So important is Berlin because it is such a small conflict. It's so tiny. And both sides are willing to risk a lot because they don't want to lose. They know if they just lose a little bit, that it's a symbol of them losing so much more. It's always been known as the double-headed eagle. Okay. Yeah, that's been their sort of symbol, their imperial symbol. And so here we have, interesting now, he's putting up, the double-headed eagle is actually...
A sausage.
You know, now one side is atrophying, they're dying. Okay, and that side would be what?
What?
That would be East Germany, right? Even though it's over here. And he puts left view and right view. Because left is what?
What? Communism.
Think about left on that social, on that political spectrum.
Yeah, so left is the East.
Left is, right, if you call somebody a left today, that means they're a Democrat. You go farther left.
You're a socialist.
A socialist, even farther left, you're
communist.
A full-on hardcore communist. So here's communism way to the left, but the right view is the successful. Hey, there's beer and pretzels, beer and sausages. Are you serious?
Whoa, we need
to break.
Wait.
Yeah. I need a break. Of those five conflicts, the third conflict I want you to know about is the Cuban Missile Crisis. Okay, great cartoon here. America, Eagle, coming down hard on...
Oh, poor little Cuba.
Right?
Oh, it's
a and what is, and he's saying drop it. What is he saying to drop?
Missile.
Drop a missile, right? Okay. This is, if you had to gauge all these events, that war almost breaks out, hey, this is the closest, the hottest, the closest we ever got to having full-on nuclear war. Jeffrey was talking about the button that he saw on Monsters vs. Aliens or whatever. Okay, this is that red button. How both guys were real close to pushing the button. What happens was is we were able to pick through satellite imagery. We were able to see, you can see here, these are actual photos of the places that they were putting the missiles. And then actually picked up ships that were coming from Russia to Cuba. And in the process of changing the tarp or lifting it up, satellites were able to pick up imagery and show that there was actually missiles on there. Hey, this is still in the news today, because I don't know if you saw